Hello all, welcome back to Babylon is Burning, the talk show where we talk about contemporary issues related to digital culture. Today in the studio we have Ben Van Duppen, a quantum physicist who knows all about smart cities. Hello, welcome to our talk show where we talk to Ben Van Duppen, a quantum physicist. And like me, you may be wondering, quantum physics and smart cities, where do those two meet? Ben.
Well, basically, I investigate in my research in quantum physics how electrons move around in two-dimensional systems, very tiny nanosystems. Now, recently, I want to make this more macroscopic phenomenon because the theories behind the movement of electrons can be regarded as very similar to how you describe people moving around in a two-dimensional grid of streets.
So people as electrons.
So basically people as electrons. Now electrons with their own will, so there are very interesting new theories that can be applied to this. But well, when doing this research, I encountered this world of what is called smart cities, where companies try to sell technology to cities to make the cities better. And as I'm also involved in local government of the city district of Borgerhout in Antwerp, I was wondering how can we use this technology for the better of the citizens and not to be locked in by big companies. And therefore, I went to investigate the concept of smart cities more deeply and the history about it.
Okay, but cities have always been filled with technology, ranging from just street lights to places where you scan your card for the subway.
Yes.
So what is new about the smart city? Isn't this just a buzzword to describe something that we've already had before?
Maybe to a certain extent, yes. But it's interesting to see where this buzzword comes from. And therefore, I brought a video.
For the first time in history, more than 50% of the people on the earth live in cities.
How do civic leaders educate the young, keep their citizens safe and healthy, and attract and facilitate commerce?
A city is a system of systems. The more we understand how those systems interact and share information, the better we can help the civic leaders to make decisions.
It's really where these systems touch each other that we can discover new ways of improving our cities.
Okay, I've caught the term system of systems and where those systems meet.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm like, if I were to explain this to my students, they would be saying, what systems of systems that meet each other?
Yeah, exactly. So what I just showed was a commercial of IBM, a big tech company, from 2011 somewhere.
Okay.
Because they started this idea of smarter systems, smarter cities. And basically the reason why they did this is because they noticed that with the financial crisis of 2008 and the consecutive debt problems of local governments, they saw an opportunity, a new market, to try to convince local governments that there is a big threat. The big threat of changing demographics, the big threat of changing climate problems, and the big threat of, well, a city is a big complex system that we cannot understand. And so you as as a mayor of the city, wouldn't it be very nice to be in control of this city and to be really in control of how we need to fight those threats?
Okay, but then when they talk about system of systems, should I think of like the transportation system, the educational system?
Well, exactly.
All of those systems and where they meet?
That's exactly what is the story, and that's interesting. There are basically two companies. You got IBM, which I show here, and they look at the at a city in a way of a system and as a collection of different systems. So there has been this kind from the 2010 onwards, this kind of narrative of, look, cities, you have problems. We are here to solve them. The only thing you need to do is invest in our technology. And we will then visualize and try to understand, try to make you understand this complex city so that you can gain more control about it. And so it's interesting to see where the smart city trend comes from, because as you said, yeah, it's some kind of fashion term, a buzzword, but mainly as a way for those companies to gain new markets and to grow, and they did successfully.
Okay.
Now by the end of the so they started lots of different experiments with this. They convinced cities. They invest themselves, but they especially convinced systems that if they would invest money into their systems, they could cut costs, because that's the idea. And then, for example, this thing came out. This is a big control room, which was built in merely 6 months in Rio de Janeiro, where they installed cameras and sensors all over the city. This is a showcase of IBM, where they really said, okay, government leaders, now you can start controlling your system the way you would like to do, and you are really on top of everything. But as you can understand, this thing raises more questions than it answers. Because they focus on technology and not on what should be solved with it, they have a big control room, gaining much more information, much more data. But if you don't really know what to do with it...
Mm-hmm. So it's a question of making meaning of the data.
Making meaning of the data, and a question of what will we be doing with it.
Okay.
And of course also privacy.
We'll talk more about that, but first we make some time for a break.
We'll return after these messages.
You've said everyone controls their data, but you're collecting data on people that are not even Facebook users, that have never signed a consent.
Welcome back to Babylon is Burning. Ben, we're talking about smart cities.
Yes.
You've questioned some of the motives of the big tech corporations involved mm-hmm. in smart city technology.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the core questions is, okay, so we can amass vast amounts of data.
Mm-hmm.
How do we make meaning of those data? But mm-hmm. when I look at things that are happening in cities, mm-hmm. in mm-hmm. areas where I've been to,
mm-hmm.
I actually see good things happening. So monitoring of flows of, for example, cyclists, and mm-hmm. then certain paths that are being redeveloped or refurbished to accommodate
mm-hmm.
Cyclists.
Mm-hmm.
Those are good evolutions, right?
Of course, of course. And so of course there are this kind of easy extensions that you can make to the data. Once you understand how it works, there are these obvious things you can do. But I think it's important as a society that we understand not only the motives of those companies, of course they also need to have some deliverables, but also understand where all this data collection is driving us through. Because with the big control room of IBM, there has been some backlash on the smart city idea. Because as you said, it's a buzzword that doesn't really have that much of more meaning mm-hmm. to it. Of course, there are some good examples, but you see that more and more companies and governments are saying, we don't know whether these big investments really made that big difference.
Mm-hmm.
You can understand, of course, by analyzing all the flows of people, where to how you should refurbish your streets. But you can also just go there and see that the streets need some refurbishment.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's always a question of what do you want to do before trying to capture data.
So are you talking about this notion of data-driven, which is again a buzzword, that the data-driven approach has limits?
Well, I think it's important to understand why we are trying to make things data driven. And it's also important to understand what are the market dynamics behind these data driven ideas. And for this, I brought a, a different visual about the big data market. Now, it's a projection where they try to understand what is the value of data. And so there are this kind of a group of 10 big companies, data brokers. And they have been valued in 2013 at a little bit over $100 billion. And right now, so in the US, right now they are expected to be in the trillions, in the US, also in the EU.
And so what I learned is the CEO of data brokerage companies, that CEO is the rich guy.
Not only that CEO is the rich guy, but also because of this immense increase in data and value of data, there are very big movements of companies that strive to get as much as data as possible.
Okay, so they basically fuel an economy.
Exactly.
The attention economy to capture data from individuals and the digital traces.
Exactly. And so right now, instead of having a solution-driven technology, we have a data-driven technology because data is value. And so right now, more and more companies are trying to get as much as data as possible without really thinking about what we will be doing with that data.
Or what will others be doing
with the data. Or what will others be doing with that data. And for example, I think a good example of this is Google, mm-hmm. who, by the way, who started the Sidewalk Labs in Toronto. And from the start of said, this is not a smart city solution. We're not doing smart city things. Cities have always been smart. But what we want to do is we want to understand and we want to give back and we want to test in real life labs. But then if you look at it, what Google is doing, for example, they're putting smart traffic lights. Mm-hmm. And you can think this is a good idea because this is congestion. Which of course is also solving it. But mm-hmm. the real motivation for Google to do that is not necessarily to combat congestion, but is to have footage of cars driving. And it's this footage of cars, this data, that actually really interested them. Because it's this data that fuels that other big buzzword, which is self-learning algorithms. Okay. And with the future of where is new technology going, the main, it's all about artificial intelligence and self-learning algorithms, but what makes something smart is the data you put into. The data that's what you really need, that's the source of information that you need to make new algorithms that are much better than what people can code. And so it's in this, that's on the one hand what makes all the data useful, that makes those data brokers and everything so powerful. But on the other hand, that's also the future. So it's important to understand, we as society, if we're going to allow these big companies to do nice things, like put for free very smart traffic lights, what's behind it and whether we are really happy with it or not.
Okay, so we all know if it's for free, usually we are the product. So that leads me to my next question. Why should I care as a citizen? So let's talk more about that after the break.
We'll return after these messages.
When you use a smiley, in which language is the smiley? Is it English? Is it Chinese? Is it German? There's no answer to it.
We're back to talk to Ben Van Duppen about smart cities. Ben, so why should I care about data brokerage that is going on with the data that's collected from me as a citizen?
Well, basically because I think that this data and this data revolution, the fourth industrial revolution that we're going through, well, as you see it right now, just as wealth is distributed very unequally over the entire world, it's also the data that's distributed unequally. And if we really want to change, to combat inequality in the world, I think it's important that we as a society are very conscious about the data that's collected about from us, but also that we take steps to take that back in control. Because otherwise, well, we're pushing the capitalist production and we're pushing inequality further and further and further.
Mm-hmm. So rather than letting other people make profit by valorizing our data streams, we should valorize them ourselves. Is that then the way forward?
Well, I think at least as society and as governments, we need to make sure that we're not left out and that we don't leave everything to the free market. Mm-hmm. And then there are, I think, two types of data. On the one hand, you got your private data about yourself, private information. I think it's important that people are aware that this is valuable, and that people can opt in if they want to, if they want other organizations or companies to do something with it, but that they are aware that this is their data. Mm-hmm. And there are some nice projects like the Decode project from the city of Barcelona and which is a European project in which they try to make a platform to have people gathering their own private data and really being able to work with this and decide who can use it and who cannot use it. And based on this platform, as cities, as governments, you can start building up new participatory projects and these kind of things. But on the other end, I think it's also very important to understand the collective nature of the data. Mm-hmm. Because every single data point in itself doesn't have any value. It's only by connecting them that you can make new things. And so we need to, I think we need to have a public debate about where we want this collective data to go. I'm completely against privatizing all the collective data. I'm completely against having this idea of all your information should only be controlled by one person. That then, in a very wrong power relation with the big companies, will decide, yeah, you can get my data or not. I think we as governments and as society should take back control also of the collective data and should collectively decide and collectively bargain and collectively organize all these data streams such that the fourth industrial revolution can build on top of that. And that is important to make this smart city concept not a concept in which we lock in private companies into our cities, but in which we use this technology to foster democracy. Mm-hmm. So, for example, with the project of getting more participatory projects, like they're trying to do in Barcelona, but also in a completely different way, and that's what we try to do in Borgerhout, is try to support citizens to stand up for themselves. And I brought a picture of a project, which is called in Dutch it's a flitsfiets. It's basically it's a problem in Antwerp that the big city has introduced a low speed regions in the city. Mm-hmm. Basically, every neighborhood you can maximum drive 30 kilometers per hour suddenly, which is a good thing, which is very nice because it's very dangerous. But they didn't really care to change the overall street layout. So the streets still look like 50, where you can drive 50, but there's just a sign saying no max 30. And so people are not really doing this because it doesn't feel like this, and the city doesn't want to invest in these things, but also doesn't want to put police officers to check.
Yeah.
And first they said, well, we cannot do that because it's 30, we don't have technical possibilities to do this, it's very hard. I mean, 30,
and
if you go 35, it's expensive and these kind of things. And so then, well, basically some citizens said, that's not true, we can do it ourselves. We can think of smart city solutions ourselves, and they just bought a big car battery, they bought a chip and a radar, and for under 300 euros, they made this box that you can put on a bicycle that measures speed. And by measuring this, they could really show, one, it's possible, two, the city is losing out thousands and thousands of euros just not by checking out, and three, the problem is gigantic because we measured speeds of up to 100 kilometers per hour in a place where you can maximum drive 30. And so it's putting this struggle of citizens, this democratic struggle of citizens, empowering that. Mm. And I think this is a different way of governments to try to think, okay, how can I empower and how can I use the smart city solutions to foster democracy?
Okay, so I'm hearing Ben Van Duppen talking, who has also a political agenda. Can you bring it back now to quantum physics to round it off?
Well, I think it's exactly the same theories. It's trying to, I mean, science should always be there for the people, and it's trying to use the scientific insight in how cities and how processes work that I want to use. I want to, what I always say, I don't only want to democratize science, but also make democracy more scientific. Okay. And that's what I'm trying to do.
Thank you, Ben, and thank you all for watching. We hope to also see you for our next show, where we will talk to Sander de Ridder about global sexual politics and digital media infrastructures, such as mobile dating app infrastructures.